Be Thou My Vision. That was our opening piece this morning, to focus our thoughts upon our great God and upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'd like to begin with Isaiah chapter 6 and verses 1 to 8, because don't we need a fresh vision of God in these days in which we live? And it says in Isaiah 6 and verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, in the midst of turmoil, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, 'Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.' Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he'd taken with tongs from the altar, and he touched my mouth and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for.' And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?' And then I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" And that's our prayer as we gather for worship this morning, that we get our eyes off everything that's happening in the world around us and get our eyes on to our great God in all his glory and majesty and might and power, and upon the Lord Jesus Christ, our great Saviour and Redeemer, and that together we would worship him this morning. So thank you for being here. Thank you for coming along to our service this morning. We have the folks from a third of our congregation present today, from the northern region, from Portadown, Richhill, Loughgall, Moy, Killyleagh, as well as the north of the Armagh city area. Thank you for being here. We'll end with the Lord's table this morning. That is, of course, for believers only. Others just observe. And just listen to the first two songs that we're having today, and we'll all sing the closing one, All Being Well. If you're joining us on Facebook or YouTube, you're particularly welcome, and thank you for joining with us on the live stream just now. We're going to pray, keeping our focus upon our great God just now, and then I'll follow up with a few more announcements after that. So let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we still our hearts in your presence just now, and we thank you for who you are, and thank you for these great Old Testament passages of Scripture that give us a tremendous insight into your glory and your majesty and your greatness and your power. Thank you for this vision that Isaiah saw at a time in his world where everything seemed to be falling apart, when a king had died who had reigned for over 50 years. Everything was stable throughout his reign. And yet all of a sudden there was doubt, there was confusion, there was wonder what was going to happen next. And he lifted his eyes and he saw you in all your power and majesty, filling the throne room of heaven. And that is what we want to see this morning, our great God seated upon his throne, filling the throne room of heaven, reminding us that he is King of kings and Lord of lords, that everything is under his sway and control. Nothing happens in this world without his say-so, even these terrible things that are happening in these days in which we live. We're reminded from the book of Genesis that we live in a fallen world. It's not how you originally created it, Heavenly Father. You created all things well. You did all things well. You saw that everything was good. And it wasn't until Genesis chapter 3 that sin entered this world through the disobedience of Adam and Eve. And because of that, and the curse that was placed upon them and upon this creation, upon this world, this planet, this universe, everything is out of sync now. We live in a fallen world. And we see disease and death and all sorts of things all around us at this time. And we're reminded that we're in a lost world. We're reminded that we ourselves are lost. Unless we come to the foot of the cross and bow the knee and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who died there for each one of us, and trust him as our Savior and trust him as our Lord and as our King, as our Sovereign. And from that moment onwards, our lives are held in the hollow of your hand, and nothing will touch us without your say-so. And so we pray that as your children gathered in your house this morning, that we would come with confidence in our hearts, in our voices, as we speak, as we pray, as we share, reminding ourselves that our God is still in control, that we're in your house, that we're still your children, that we're still part of your family. Nothing has changed as far as that is concerned. And nothing as far as our future has changed either. Because one day you're going to keep us, you're going to preserve us, you're going to sanctify us. One day you're going to glorify us in your presence with the Lord Jesus Christ in that new heaven and new earth you've gone to prepare for us. So Lord, lift our eyes out of the moment. Lift our eyes to that glorious future and help us to keep pressing on with you until that day dawns. Father, we pray for a number of folks in our fellowship who are not so well at this time. We bring Lily before you. Thank you she's back home again with Elaine, and pray your continued blessing on her life just now. We pray for Ray in a nursing home here in Armagh. We pray that you'll draw near and minister into her life at this time also. We pray for Billy Reed's sister, who's not well in hospital either. And we ask you, Lord, to continue to care for these individuals, these loved ones, and watch over them, we pray, for your own name's sake. And Father, as we move ahead into the weeks and months that lie ahead, none of us knows what's going to happen in society around us, as schools start back, as universities go back, as people return to their jobs and all the rest of it. Lord, you're in control. We rest in that. And as far as our church is concerned and all the other activities that normally get started back at this time of year, Lord, we pray for wisdom as a church leadership in these days. You'd help us to make good decisions and right decisions as far as all of those activities are concerned. And you'd lead us day by day, week by week, month by month, into the future, doing exactly what it is that you want us to do and seeking to bring glory and honour to your name. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, folks, it is good to be back with you after a few weeks of break. Paul and Deborah are off this weekend, and they'll be back again later on this week, and then we're into the usual routine of things starting back late August, early September. Just a few things for the incoming week, just to say that this Wednesday night, the 26th of August at 8 o'clock, we have our Bible study and prayer meeting down in our main church hall. I'll be leading that meeting, and James Todd, one of our deacons, will be the speaker on Joseph from Hebrews chapter 11. And that brings that series to a conclusion. And thanks to all the men from our preachers group who have been ministering to us Wednesday by Wednesday throughout the summer. And we say you all did very well indeed. And thank you very much for the work you put in behind the scenes for that. So we look forward to Wednesday night with James to conclude that series. And then next Sunday is the 30th of August, the last Sunday of the summer, as we would know it. And at 11 o'clock in the morning, we'll gather here once again for morning service and worship. And next Sunday, that's going to take the form of the Katie send-off. We've been planning for this and preparing for this for quite some time, that on the first Sunday morning in September, the folks in Katie would begin to meet there in the TMAC every Sunday morning from then on. And those folks happen to be in the building next Sunday. That's the area from Milford to Middletown to Katie to Newton Hamilton and back into Armagh again. Those are the folks who'll be here in church next week. That includes Johnny Thompson's and Paul McAdam's eldership groups. And we'll be officially sending off some of those people to begin to meet every Sunday morning in the TMAC Katie from Sunday the 6th of September, with the intention of forming a church there in the not too distant future. So will you pray about all of that? A very special service next Sunday morning. Loved of everybody here in the building for that. That's just not possible at the moment. But if you're not here, would you please watch online and pray very much for those who will be heading out from us to Katy in the coming days. Can I say there'll be an elders meeting on Tuesday the 1st September at 7:30 here in the coffee area of the church building. And the deacons will meet the following Tuesday night, the 8th of September. And obviously at both of those meetings we'll be reviewing our COVID-19 measures. We've been back to church 2 months now, it's hard to believe. And little by little we've been getting back to some sense of normality. And folks have been watching online. But we need to review all of that in the current climate. And just pray for wisdom for our elders and deacons as we work our way through all of those details over these next couple of weeks, and we'll let the rest of the congregation know as soon as we possibly can. Now, we have heard our first piece, Be Thou My Vision. We've sought God's face together in prayer. I'm now going to ask Wilson to come and share with the boys and girls just now, Wilson Thompson. I see his two girls brightening up straight away, looking forward to hearing what Daddy's going to say. So over to Wilson. Good to have you, and thank you very much indeed.
All right, boys and girls, I hope you're all keeping well and having a good summer. It's a bit of a strange summer, isn't it? We haven't been able to do a big pile and we haven't been able to go too far, but I want to tell you what we've been up to this summer. So this summer, we have a wee boat and we decided to go out on it a few times on the water and have a bit of fun. But as much as I'd like to talk to you about me having great fun on the boat, I want to talk to you instead about some of the tools that I bring with us when we're on the boat. So, first of all, we have a life jacket, and just to make, this doesn't fit me, this isn't mine, all right? As much as you'd like to think it would, it doesn't. This is Minnie's wee life jacket, and it is quite Minnie. And you'd all agree you'd need this on a boat, wouldn't you? This here is a vital piece of kit that would stop you from drowning, isn't that right? So, we'll have a life jacket. Another tool that you might need is a map and a compass. And you all agree, if you're in stormy weather or if you're a bit lost, you need a map and compass with you on a boat. To be fair, I don't go that far, so I don't really need it. And the last piece of kit, which to be fair I haven't used, but is very important on a boat, is indeed an anchor. And the purpose of an anchor is, if you're out in sea and it gets stormy and you're starting to drift and can't control the boat, you throw the anchor into the water, it'll grab a rock and you won't move. You'll be steadfast and firm and you will not move. And you're probably thinking, well, that's great, he's brought all his lovely tools with him to church, but how could he relate that to us and the Bible? Well, if you think about it, Jesus is a wee bit like a life jacket. A life jacket won't let you drown. Jesus is also our security for us. And you're thinking, well, how? Well, if you remember, if you read in the Bible, Jesus had to come down from heaven onto earth and bore all our sin on the cross for us. He had to die for us so that we could have a place in heaven with God. And you're thinking, well, how? But how has he saved us? Well, in the Bible, there's an awful place called hell. And if we don't accept Jesus, if we don't wear the life jacket, which is Jesus, we are going to that awful place. So I would definitely recommend you put on Jesus as your life jacket. The map and compass, you're wondering, how could you relate that to anything? Well, the map and compass is a wee bit like our Bible. When we're going through a bit of a storm, we can search through the Bible and find passages that can help us navigate our way out of a storm. And it's full of do's and don'ts, right and wrongs, should and shouldn'ts, and it can be a great help to us when we are going through a wee bit of trouble or a storm. And lastly, the anchor. And our hope is in an anchor. Our hope is in our trust in Jesus. That brings us to our memory verse, which is, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. And you're wondering, well, what does that really mean? Well, to understand that verse, we kind of need to read another verse to explain it. And our verse is John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, God had sent his Son to die for us to take away our sin. But we need to accept Jesus. We need to put our life jacket on. We need to be safe so that we can be sure of God's promises of an eternity spent with him in heaven. So boys and girls, next time you're going through a storm, or you're going to school, you're going through a wee hard time, just remember the life jacket. Jesus came to die for you, to save you from your sins. And read your Bible. It'll help you navigate through that storm. And last of all, keep your hope in God's promises. God has lots of promises throughout the Bible, and he has never, ever broken one of them promises. So put all your faith in God, and he will keep you safe. And that's my story this morning. So thanks very much for your time.
Indeed, Wilson, what he didn't tell you was that during lockdown he took the old battered boat and he made it into a new one, and he did a great job. I've seen the before and after pictures, and I'm sure the girls really love getting out on it during the summer. So thank you very much indeed, Wilson, for sharing that story with us, reminding us that Jesus is our anchor. We're going to have another video clip just now of My Lighthouse for kids, and over to the guys for that just now.
Fly before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. Fly before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. Fly before us.
see some of the boys and girls doing the actions there. Well done. That was great. Now we're going to turn to John chapter 17 once again. John 17, beginning at verse 20, reading down to the end of the chapter. And this is going to be our focus over the next two Sunday mornings. John chapter 17, beginning at verse 20. If you have your Bible there, please follow it with me. Jesus is praying from the beginning of this chapter. It says in verse 1, when Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father. And then he's prayed for a number of things in the first 19 verses. And then we come to verse 20. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one even as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. We pray that God would bless this reading of his word to our hearts this morning. So today we're returning to our series in the high priestly prayer of Jesus in John 17. So far this summer we've heard Jesus praying for four things: his own glorification and our salvation in verses 1 to 5, our preservation in verses 6 to 15, and our sanctification in verses 16 to 19. So the first two focused on the work that Jesus accomplished for us at the cross. The second two focused on the word, that we're kept by the word of God and we're sanctified through the word of God. And the last two that we're looking at this week and next focus on the church. So let me read that final section to you again. First of all, verses 20 to 23, that we're going to focus on just now. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word or their message, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and love them even as you loved me. So here Jesus prays for our oneness, our unity, or our unification within the church. That's what I think about this morning. And then next week we'll see Jesus praying for the final glorification of the church from verse 24. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. So that's where we're going over these next two Sunday mornings, thinking about Jesus praying for our unification today, and next Sunday Jesus praying for our glorification. So this morning, as we listen, Jesus prays for our unification within the church in verses 20 to 23. And as soon as you mention the word unity, people immediately jump to all sorts of conclusions. They hear ecumenism. All churches unite, or all religions unite. Set aside your differences. For the world's sake, present a united front regardless of your differences behind the scenes. For example, this week we heard the leaders of the four main churches in Northern Ireland speaking together with one voice on the need to wear face masks in churches during the COVID-19 epidemic. Nothing wrong with that. They're just speaking on a social issue affecting society today. They weren't worshipping together or compromising any theological points whatsoever. But obviously, Irish Baptists are not one of the four main churches in Northern Ireland, so we weren't part of that statement in the way the Roman Catholic Church or the Church of Ireland or the Presbyterians or the Methodists are. No, we are a voluntary association of Baptist churches in Ireland, around about 117 churches. We have a lot of independency built into our view of the church. We're not one church across the whole island. We're individual churches in different towns and villages across Ireland who do our own thing, led and guided by Scripture and by local elders. And in most matters, we would regard the coming together of the four main churches as false ecumenism, presenting a facade of unity at all costs, despite sincerely held biblical and doctrinal differences behind the scenes. So we're not part of that main grouping. But on the other hand, you would think sometimes that unity was a bad word in evangelical circles. We fall out about this and that or the other thing that aren't usually major points of doctrine, but more to do with personalities and preferences, forms of worship or witness. Why has the devil got the victory over us so much as far as our unity within evangelical circles is concerned? The last thing the devil wants is for the true church of Jesus Christ to be united. As long as he can keep evangelical churches divided, he can discredit the gospel as much as he likes. And he's often busy trying to drive wedges between us all. But here in John 17, we find that Jesus prayed that his church would be united. And so we need to take this matter very seriously indeed. If Jesus prayed for it, then it must be important. It must be his will that his church is united. And therefore, it should be our concern as well. So let's notice some things about this unity that Jesus prayed for this morning. First of all, from verse 20, who are we to unite with? Who are we to unite with? It says in verse 20, I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. Those who will believe in me through their word. Who are we to unite with? Jesus said, my prayer is not for them alone. We need to remember who that word them refers to. Go back to verse 6. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you've given me is from you. For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them, and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine and them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one even as we are one. While I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Who does them refer to in verse 20? Answer, it refers to the original 12 disciples or apostles of Jesus. In fact, only the first 11, because he says, I'm not praying for the son of destruction in verse 12. He's praying for his 11 disciples, his 11 apostles. That's who Jesus has been praying for up until this point in his prayer. But now in verse 20, he says, I don't ask for these alone or for them alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. So Jesus has been praying for his apostles who have been with him while he was here on earth, his last 3 years of ministry. But now he pauses and he looks down through all the ages of time since, right down to today and beyond, and he says, I pray also for those who will believe in me through the message that my apostles will preach. He prays that all of those people, in other words, the apostles and those who would believe in their message, might be united together as one. So Jesus is here praying that all true believers of all time might be united as one. All those who have believed and accepted the message the apostles preached. Go back to Acts chapter 2, where Peter preached on the day of Pentecost. And he got conviction in the hearts and lives of those who were listening to him. And they said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And he said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Your sins will be forgiven, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." That's the message that the apostles preached as the gospel. This cannot refer to one visible church structure being united, because many of these people are already now in heaven. The apostles themselves are in heaven right now. So it is the invisible, universal church of all time that Jesus is praying for and talking about here. Remember that word church, ecclesia, means individuals who have been called out of the world and they believe personally in Jesus Christ as their Lord and as their Savior. That's who believers are. They're ones who have been called out of the world to belong to Christ. And as believers, we today are part of that body, the same church that the apostles were part of. So we're united with them as well as with all believers of all time. We're united by doctrine, teaching the same gospel message, and we're united by faith, faith placed in the same finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. And so in verses 20 and 21, we're united with the apostles, but according to verse 20, we're also united with all those who have come to believe in Jesus through the gospel. In other words, we should experience true unity with all truly born again believers in Christ wherever we find them. Now, that doesn't mean that we're to unite with all churchgoers everywhere, but with all the individuals in all the churches worldwide who have personally believed in Jesus Christ through the gospel. A deep spiritual unity is being prayed for here, that we would know that bond whenever we meet a fellow believer in the Lord, whoever they are, whatever background they've come from, wherever we find them in the world, that we know that deep spiritual bond and unity with them wherever we go. In fact, it's actually impossible for believers to have fellowship with unbelievers, according to 2 Corinthians 6 and verses 14 and 15. It says there, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever?" It is impossible to have true fellowship between a believer and an unbeliever. It is spiritually impossible to unite with all churchgoers everywhere, because many of them are not truly born again believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's what Jesus is praying for here. And there are two further criteria that Jesus spelled out for us back in verses 6 to 8. We're to unite with those who accept the authority of God's word, the Bible, and have not deviated from it. Look at verse 6. "I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word." They have kept your word. Also verse 8, "For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them, and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me." So the importance of believing and keeping God's word is something that should unite true believers together in the Lord. A mark of true believers is that they will be Bible-centered people. They will be word people. And that's why in our church, both on Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, Wednesday nights, throughout our youth and children's ministries, the Word of God is central. Because that's what makes us truly evangelical believers in Christ. Because we're centered on the Word of God. And we're to unite with those who accept that Jesus Christ has come from God. Look at verse 7. "Now they know that everything that you've given me is from you. For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they've received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me." They must believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he is God come in the flesh. So another mark of true believers is that they're Christ-centered people, believing him to be the very Son of God come in the flesh. So we accept the deity of Christ, that he's God the Son, that he's the only mediator between God and mankind. Many false cults would not accept those points that I've just mentioned. And to complete the picture from verse 20, true believers will also have accepted and believed the one true apostolic gospel. In other words, the same gospel the apostles preached. True believers will be gospel-centered people. people of the cross. So Bible-centered people, Christ-centered people, and gospel-centered people. Those are the people that we should unite together with. Those are the three criteria that Jesus himself used in this prayer for Christian unity. These, therefore, are the criteria that we should use today as we talk about unity. We have an obligation upon us, if we're Bible-believing, Christ-centered, gospel-preaching people, to foster unity with other Christians in other churches who are Bible-believing, Christ-centered, and gospel-preaching. We don't just drop all our standards and unite with anybody, but we ought to reach out the hand of friendship and fellowship to all those who meet these same three criteria. And if you think about it for a moment, it makes sense. We seek to foster unity with such people because we're already spiritually united to them through Christ. We don't have to make the unity, but we have to foster the unity that already exists between us. And that's exactly what Paul says in Ephesians 4 and verse 1. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who's over all and through all and in you all. So we're called to maintain the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace with anybody we meet who's a true believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. So where there are Bible-believing, Christ-centered, gospel-preaching churches in and around Armagh, then we will try to have good relationships with them. We will pray for one another, and the ministers do meet together for prayer on a regular monthly basis. And we seek to encourage one another, and from time to time we can work together as long as that work is centered on the gospel. We look back over the last 5 years or so, working together under a Passion for Life Armagh banner, holding missions in the hotel here in Armagh, and seeing people coming under the sound of the gospel and a number of folks trusting Christ as their Savior. So where we can, we will work together with other churches who are centered on the gospel. We unite with Bible-believing, Christ-centered, gospel-preaching people. That's the first thing. But why are we to unite with them? Look at verse 21. Why are we to unite with them? Jesus says in this prayer, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. So that the world may believe that you have sent me. Jesus believed that true Christian unity would be a testimony to the watching world that he had indeed come, that the Father had indeed sent the Son into the world. Now, the devil's a master of confusion, and I'm sure he's gloating over all the organized ecumenism that has gone on in recent years, where so-called Christian denominations across the world have thrown aside the criteria that we've just outlined for you above and have just united with anyone. But it hasn't encouraged the world to believe that Jesus has come, has it? In fact, quite the opposite. Jesus prayed that true believers would unite and be seen by the world to be united in order that the world might believe that Jesus has come into the world. But sadly, the devil has caused such confusion that the church in these days is anything but a testimony to the world. All sorts of churches have laid down their doctrinal distinctives and have united together. But the problem is that nobody knows what they believe anymore, and therefore the gospel that could save this world has been lost in the middle of all the confusion. And that's why we need to stand out as different. Four square on the Bible as God's word, clear on who Jesus is, fully God and fully man in the one person, clear on why he has come to redeem us from our sins by his once and for all sacrificial death for us on the cross. In other words, we're called to be Bible-believing, Christ-centered, and gospel-preaching churches. But in verse 23, Jesus prays for perfect unity. He says, I in them and you in me, may they become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Jesus prays for perfect unity. Why? So that the world, whether they believe in him or not, will know without any excuse that Jesus has come into the world and that Jesus has loved us, his church, in the same way that the Father loved him. Ephesians 5 talks about the Lord Jesus Christ, and it talks about the church being his bride. And he gave himself up for her to present her spotless, holy, as a radiant bride, perfect in every way. And that is Christ's goal for his church. It is to make us holy. It is to make us radiant. It is to get to the point that we're without blemish and we're blameless. And therefore we must be biblical, Christ-centered, and gospel-believing and proclaiming. But we must also be united, truly united. Why? Because a divided church is not a blameless one. A divided church is not a blameless one. And that's why Jesus prays for our unity so earnestly in these closing verses of this prayer. Who are we to unite with? Why are we to unite with them? And thirdly and finally, if Jesus desires our unity so much, what should our response be? What should our response be? We too should pray for true unity to be seen in Christ's church. We should pray against the confusion of false ecumenism. We should seek to replace false unity with true unity around those three criteria: the deity of Christ, the authority of the Bible, and faith in the gospel that the apostles preached. But just like charity, unity must begin at home. So let me ask you the question here this morning: how do you get on with other believers in this church? How do you get on with other believers in this church? As Ephesians 4:3 says, do you make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace? How do you get on with other believers in this church? And how do you get on with other true believers in other churches? Are there things that evangelical Christians can do together in an area that we couldn't do on our own? Of course there are. And in the past, we've served together in momentum teams here in Armagh, as well as in the Passion for Life events in Armagh City as well. But wherever we go in this world, if we find other people who fit these criteria, then we need to put out our hand, if we could in these days, and accept them as brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of the three criteria we've identified in Jesus' prayer for what constitutes a true believer, I believe it is not churches coming together or some new organizational structure that we need. It is simply individual believers from whatever church background, acknowledging and accepting other true believers from whatever background they come from, and seeking to encourage one another and to help one another and work together with them for the sake of the gospel. And I think that is what will speak volumes to the watching skeptical world that we live in these days. Now, as I close, let me just apply this to what we're going to be doing next Sunday. Because next Sunday, we're going to be sending out some people from this church to plant a new church in the town of Katy, about 10 miles south of here. How can we do that without some kind of division creeping in among us? Well, there's no doubt about it, planting a church from an existing church could cause division. Some could be for it and some could be against it. Some could go with it, and some could stay behind who we thought might have gone with it in the first place. We've been working on this for about 5 years altogether now, so nothing has been rushed. We've given everybody who lives in the area every opportunity to decide whether or not to be part of the new work in Katy. No one has been forced to do anything against their will. God has led and guided some to go and not others, and we accept that. But this is not a group of people who have become disgruntled with Armagh Baptist Church and want to break away to do their own thing. Not at all. In fact, we're sending out some of our best and most committed folk next Sunday, and we will miss them. But for the greater good, and because of the great need in the Katy area and beyond, and because many of our folk live there, and because we're full here in Armagh, if we're all allowed to meet together in the one place at the one time, it's time for them to go and to establish a new church in their own area. How does that affect our relationship with other churches in that Katy area already? Well, if they're Bible-believing, Christ-centered, and gospel-preaching, then I'm sure that in the days that lie ahead, there'll be opportunity for fellowship and for working together for the sake of the gospel and true Christian unity. But if not, if they've deviated from the gospel and from the scriptures, then that's a different matter altogether. For the sake of the purity of the gospel, we will have to go it alone, so that this world might know that Christ has come and that there is one Saviour for sinners, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's for the sake of the gospel that we're doing it. So as far as Armagh and Katie going their separate ways is concerned, will that affect our unity? Absolutely not. We will continue to maintain strong bonds of love and unity and support between mother and daughter churches for many years to come, God willing. And as we see the gospel go forward into a needy area, we will stand with them all the way. And so I ask every believer here this morning and watching online, connected to our church, will you make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace in these coming days? And even coming out of these days of lockdown and COVID restrictions and all the rest of it, there's so much potential for division. As some want us to go faster and some want us to go slower, will you make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace in our church in these days? May God bless his word to our hearts. And now we're going to remember Jesus' death for us in the way that he has asked us to, by breaking bread and drinking wine together. The bread represents his body broken for us on the cross, as we think of all that he suffered there for us in his crucifixion. And the wine represents his blood that was shed for us on the cross, as we remember the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin, according to 1 John 1 and verse 7. Jesus simply asks us to do this in remembrance of him. And so this morning I'm going to ask Stephen, one of our elders, to give thanks for the bread that speaks of Jesus' body that was broken for us. And then a number of our office bearers will pass among you holding out the communion trays. And there are two cups inside each other. Please lift them out together, being careful not to touch anybody else. Separate the cups and go ahead and eat the bread, first of all, yourself. Continue to hold the cup of wine in your hand until the office bearers have returned here to the front of the church. And then I'm going to ask Paul, another one of our elders, to give thanks for the wine. And then we'll drink the cup together as a symbol of our unity in Christ, the very thing we've been thinking about this morning. And then I'm going to ask you to stand as we sing our closing hymn this morning. And it's the wonderful hymn, "The Church's One Foundation is Jesus Christ, Her Lord." I think we should stand as we sing that together this morning as a proclamation of who we are and what we stand for as a church. And while we're doing that, the office bearers will pass among you once more for you to drop your empty cups into a plastic bag, which will then be taken straight out to the bin. And then I'll close our service in prayer. After that, please leave quickly and quietly. Two deacons will open these exit doors for the front half of the congregation, and two deacons will guide the remainder out through the back of our church building, guiding you out row by row to the door that you'll leave by. Please follow these instructions carefully for your own safety and for the safety of those around you, and we'd appreciate that very much indeed. Now I'm going to ask Stephen if he'd lead us, first of all, in giving thanks for the bread. Thank you.
Father, this morning we thank you for your word that we have already heard, both in the children's talk and also from Ian. And Father, we thank you that we are found today united in you. But Father, we realize that that has only been made possible because of that supreme sacrifice that Christ made on the cross of Calvary. And as we come around this table this morning, Father, and we take this bread, it reminds us of the pain and the suffering and the sacrifice that he made as he left heaven's glory, as he came down to this old earth, as he took on the form of man, and as he lived that sinless life, and then ultimately gave himself completely in the Father's will to take away my sin. And so, Father, as we take that bread this morning, we thank you for the unity that we have in you. We thank you for the promises that we have. We thank you that we are steadfast and sure, no matter what storms of life may bring, we are grounded in Christ. And Father, we thank you that one day we will see you face to face. But Father, as we take that bread this morning, we pray that we will give you thanks from our hearts for all that you've done for us as individuals, as families, and as a fellowship. And we rejoice this morning, even in the midst of all that is going on around us in this world, that we have that surety found in you. Accept of our thanks, we pray, in Jesus' name, for this bread. Amen.
Now I'll ask Paul to give thanks for the wine. Thank you.
Father, we just thank and we just praise you that we can meet in this manner. Again, we just thank you, Lord, we can gather around this table and to worship and to praise you and to thank you for all that your Son has done for us. We thank you, Lord, how he lived a sinless, perfect life, how he died a sinner's death and there paid the price for our sins. And Father, we thank you, Lord, through the shedding of his blood that we have been redeemed. And Father, we just give you thanks now for this wine which reminds us of that blood so freely shed for us. And Father, we want to worship you and praise you and thank you from the bottom of our hearts. So Father, we just do that now. We ask it in your name. Amen.
The symbol of our unity together in Christ. And now let's stand as our praise team comes forward to lead us in the singing of "The Church's One Foundation is Jesus Christ, Her Lord." Thank you.
Church is one.
ourselves in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for your presence with us this morning and for your help given. Thank you for once again allowing us to listen into the prayer of our Lord Jesus Christ for each one of us. And as he has prayed for our unity and continues to pray for our unity at your right hand, we pray that we would be the answers to his prayer, even this morning and in the coming days, that we will make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace among us as a church family here in Armagh, among the new group that will start to meet in Katy, between those two groups in the years that lie ahead in your will, and with every true believer of the Lord Jesus Christ, as we meet them wherever, in work or in the community or in other churches, help us to foster that unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace among us, being true to the gospel that you've given to us, true to your word that you've given to us, and true to the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us on the cross of Calvary to redeem his bride and to one day make us spotless and pure and perfect for all eternity. Bless your word to all our hearts and give us grace to put your word into practice. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.